All right, everybody, and welcome to episode 319 of the 9 Years podcast. I am Nick Draper, joined, as always, by the face of the BBC Sport website, Mr. Stuart Deakins. And later on in this week's episode, we'll be joined by Esther and Kerry of the Women of Wimbledon Supporters Association to talk about WOWSA, to talk about the group and what it's doing, what its aims are, and what it's achieved so far. But Stu and I, in the meantime, are going to talk, I'm very sorry to say, about first team affairs. Men's first team's affairs, obviously, because the women are still doing pretty well, to be honest with you, Stu, and they've got a cup final coming up at the end of the month as well that we'll mention later on. But we do have to talk, and we will talk about the men's first team, the defeat to bottom of the table Rochdale on Saturday. Echoes of previous seasons for me, Stu. A few weeks ago, we talked about the end of the 97-98 season, where we only won one of the last 12 or something like that. I think we won away at Southampton, if you remember, when their goalkeeper, Paul Jones, fell on his backside and Carl Leburn scored into an empty net at the Dell. Same happened the following season, 98-99. We just seemed to be given 3 points to every relegation-threatened team in that run-in. I remember the end of the first season in the conference. If you remember, we had finished the season really poorly. It concluded with a 1-0 defeat away at Gateshead on the last day of the season. We lost 2-0 at home to Grays. If you remember, Grays were a complete crisis club at the time. Similar ending to the end of our first season in League One, when we didn't score a goal for the final 6 games of the campaign. It has echoes of that.
Yeah, it did. We said, didn't we, before the game that, you know, you had a team that had to get something, had to win, couldn't really take a draw. New manager bounce, all that sort of stuff. And then you had a team who, yes, had won a game against Walsall, but could they put back-to-back wins together? And really, we asked our own questions, didn't we? The frustrating thing was is that, you know, the previous games had loads of goals. I think a 3-2 win Kings Meadow last time, then a 3-3 draw behind closed doors at Plough Lane. So there had been goals, and of course, we all thought it'd be goals, and there was just one.
It was a great goal, though. I mean, if there were any neutral, well, there was some neutrals attending. We'll come on to that in a moment. But for a neutral watching, that was a cracking goal. Just, you know, an absence of players perhaps wanting to stick a foot in on the edge of the box, maybe. But I thought they worked it quite well. I thought fair play to them.
Yeah, we were trying to put a challenge in, weren't we? It's interesting because when you look at Lloyd, I think he's played for quite a few clubs, decent player. When we looked at their team and looked at their bench, they got good individual players, we felt, didn't we? Mm-hmm. Scott Quigley on the bench, you know, Andy Thorn, not really fine. When he came on, it was like, wow, he could have played for Walsall the other week. Mm-hmm. Good individual players. And it's obviously a team that just hasn't clicked for whatever reason. And of course, they clicked on Saturday.
Yeah, I mean, kind of. It wasn't a great game, was it? Let's be honest. Their goal was their only shot on target in the entire game. Their only shot in the second half, I believe. I just felt in areas, lots of nice football, lots of nice triangles around the pitch, but no cutting edge, never got them anywhere until obviously they scored the goal. Aside from that, I could kind of see why they are bottom of the league, to be honest with you. They looked, I mean, you talk about Quigley coming on as a bit of a man mountain. They had the 2 centre-halves as well that were tall and one thing's in the air, but otherwise I felt, you know, midfield, I didn't see anything in there for them, to be honest with you. A little bit of lack of bite, maybe. All very nice. A team that didn't complain to the referee, didn't get in the referee's face. Do you know what I mean? One of those just seemed like, and from reports I've heard as well about the club and the people behind the scenes, just I always felt that Rochdale are just a very nice kind of club, and they perhaps a little bit too nice this season.
Yeah, and this isn't a nice league, is it? You know, we've said before,
That's a very polite way of putting it.
It's just a horrible league, isn't it? You've got to win your battles. You've got to fight for each ball. And, you know, obviously we've got quite a few injuries at the moment, and we've got some of those players who would fight for those balls or the shithousery in terms of the Pels of this world and stuff like that. So, hey, look, it's all about it. I'm not going to say if we had a full team out, we'd have beaten them. But, yeah, it was a bit too nice. And, you know, in terms of we just didn't really get our foot in. For once we used all subs, but none of them really made a difference to the game on that side of it. Well, can I just say, just sidestepping, 5 subs, that's nothing compared to anything. West Ham versus, who did I play the other night? Newcastle. There were 7 subs made at the same time. Four from West Ham, three from Newcastle. It was like a pre-season game. You know, it was just like, all right, all off, all on, all off, all on.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I just, Joe, I thought, I was going to give you a quick call and go, you need to see this. This is modern football, but I thought better not.
Now, you know, it would just wind me up and I'd be in a rage for the rest of the evening. It remind me of
I
old...
was in a rage because I was like Paul Adam Smith, like the commentator went, I'll give you 5 minutes to work out if they change shape and who's going where. There's seven new players on the pitch.
Does
It's
it not make
just...
a little bit of a mockery of the game when it changes to that degree? It's like watching an NFL game or an England friendly under Sven Goran Eriksson.
Yes. Yeah, good link. Good link. Who we're playing on Monday. England players, Mr. Beckhams.
It took me a while there. Do you know what? You were ahead of me on that link there. I was thinking, who we? Well, the first thing I had to think is, who the hell are we playing on Monday? Because
Yeah.
at this point, Stu, the season's over. My head's gone. I have no idea. Like, can I please tell the listeners what happened today, please? Because we've already just repeated this story before I was recording. But this it's not just me that's head's gone on this season, all right, listeners? Okay, so I was going into Wimbledon, so I'm on Easter holidays now. I went into school this morning, so I was in at 9 o'clock this morning. I was in school doing work, as we do in our Easter holidays. You know, that 13 weeks holiday we always get told teachers have and they shouldn't moan about. Yeah.
Too many holidays.
Yeah, absolute nonsense. So I was in school at 9 o'clock this morning. But anyway, so then I was later going into Wimbledon about for lunch. I was getting some lunch in Wimbledon today. So got the train at 1 o'clock from Berylands train station. As I'm walking up the steps, who do I see? I see Ethan Chislett fully kitted out in his training kit. And then I thought, strange, but obviously getting the train home from training. As I went further up, I noticed pretty much the whole squad, including Johnny Jackson and Terry Skiverton, are on the platform waiting to get the train. A little bit awkward for me. I didn't really say anything, just sort of skulked because they were at the front end. Obviously, they were going to Waterloo and changing there. I was going to Wimbledon. I needed the back of the train, so I had to walk down the platform. And I messaged you just to say, look, really sort of, I didn't know how to approach the situations. So I almost just kind of kept my head down and just carried on walking. But all the squad were on the platform getting the train. Your response to me was, where are they going?
Season's gone. I've lost track of days. Like, it's a Thursday. It was only when you put Harrogate, I'm like, oh yeah, there's a game of football going on. Not that I don't know about it. And I'm thinking, have they got a ticket? And yeah, it was yeah, a bit embarrassing. But that's what it's like, though, isn't it? Do you know what I mean? Like, I'm glad you reminded me there's a game tomorrow because I'm just lost with days at the moment.
Yes, and it might be, well, hopefully this will go out tonight, but this might be going out Friday morning. So if anyone listening confused, the game is on Good Friday, away to Harrogate. Anyway, to go back very quickly, you know, we've come a long way from where we started at that point, which originated with substitutes. And as you said, Stu, we did make the five subs against Rochdale. They didn't really have an impact. Of anyone that had or looked to the most threatening of those that came on, I thought Sam Pearson was probably the first time I've looked at him and really thought somebody that could perhaps influence games. I know he's had cameos here and there, but I've thought perhaps his impact was overstated somewhat prior to Friday. I mean, truth of the matter is, you know, we didn't equalise, we didn't really create enough or anywhere near enough chances or anything like that. We was all very, I just felt if we'd have been on the front foot from the first minute and really looked to take the game to them, perhaps even starting with Ali and giving him 45 minutes and then taking him off maybe, just to you, because I'd love him, Psycho Janna. Is no solution as a lone centre forward whatsoever, is he?
Well, it's the same problem we've had all season. We just don't have the firepower up front. You know, we relied on Josh Davidson for too long, and now he's got a groin strain. And, you know, we interviewed him, didn't we, on the show on Saturday, and he thinks he'll be back in about 3 weeks. But then your replacements, we don't really have them. You know, Jana's come in as a, I don't think he's an out and out forward. He's more of a wide player. Actually, even when DJ coming back in, when he came on, he played up top, but he's not really an out and out forward. And there's your problems. That's. You know, I think with Al Hammadi, my understanding was he had a really late fitness test. So I think even just getting on the bench was probably as much. I know you probably can start them, but I get the feeling that they really wanted to bring him on if they had to, or maybe when the pace has gone down a little bit. But yeah, I think it's the same thing. You know, subs coming on, decent subs, but yeah, there was no cutting edge. You're right. It was a very. I thought George Marsh had one of his better games on Saturday and played well again on Tuesday night. Because it just feels to me there's a little bit more space in terms of maybe that Rochdale dropped off, didn't really attack the ball. We didn't really do that either. And you could have got mistaken for thinking it was just a well, an end of season dead rubber. But it was obviously more than that for Rochdale, but it just felt flat.
I mean, yeah, you say it's more than that for Rochdale, but realistically, and especially on the evidence of that, they're not going to stay up, I think. You're asking them to outperform two teams, and the first job of that is closing a six-point gap to Hartlepool, which I think is still a big ask with the amount of games they've got left. So I guess it was a kind of dead rubber in a sense.
Yeah. But,
hey.
But then, you know, hey, look, we've got above 7,000 in terms of fans. Hey, look, we've said it before, like, bums on seats is probably a bit different. But even just the general atmosphere. And we had the customary boo, didn't we, at the end, which even that felt flat.
I was surprised at how loud it was, though, given clearly the win on the Tuesday, you referenced there the Tuesday game you referenced with George Marsh playing well, was the last Tuesday against Warsaw. I thought that might have given them a little bit more leeway on Saturday, but no, that booing was still pretty loud. I mean, it is two wins in 17 games now, and you have just lost to the team bottom of the league.
And you know, we're going to come on to it in a bit, aren't we, with a Craig Cope interview. But I think it's now just a situation of waiting. Some fans are waiting for one thing. Some fans are waiting for something else. Some of the other fans don't know what they're waiting for. Everyone's in a little bit of limbo. It's just like, literally, just if you call the season off now, done. You know, we don't need to play our games. We're not going to get relegated realistically.
Do it. Please call it off now.
It feels like a chore, doesn't it? And that's your problem. That's your problem, because the season's really just died a death. And it's now a case of just, look, do you know what? Let's just get through the summer. We were expecting an exciting summer. The sun should be out and all that sort of palaver. And let's start again.
I'm trying to think what's a good example of maybe sort of a subject that I didn't really like at school. There wasn't a subject I didn't like. This is the problem. But, you know, maybe something like, for argument's sake, IT, all right? Because that's not a subject I did for GCSE. So come year nine, at this time of year, every parent, every child, everyone will know this. Now you get into the final term of year nine, you've got a host of subjects that you're not carrying through to GCSE. So your motivation for these is minimal. Okay, so this is where I feel like, you know, long week at school and you get like double IT on a Friday afternoon. It's only going to be an hour and a half or 2 hours, but it might as well be a lifetime. And that's what I feel about three more games this season that I've got to put myself through at Plough Lane, because it feels like torture now. I couldn't believe it. The other week after Crawley, I was working it out and I was like, well, there's not many games left. And I looked at it. We still have five games at Plough Lane. I was like, for fuck's sake. Why? And there are lots of people that have thought, why are you doing this to yourself, Nick? Just don't go. And I kind of feel like, you know what, I can't not go. But it does feel like, oh, it's only three games of football, Stu, but it might as well be 30, the way I feel right now.
No, do you know what? You got me thinking, actually, with school, obviously quite a long while ago. But mine was very like design technology, where I sort of had no interest. I'm not really creative. But I turned up. I got my mark, but I was looking out the window daydreaming about what's happening around the corner. Do you know what I mean? Not really concentrating. Don't want to be there. But I feel like you just said, I had to be there. Got my mark. And it's like the players turning up at the moment. The players are like, well, yeah, I'm just getting my appearance. I'm going. It feels like some of them are going through the motions, and I get it. Because I think there's going to be an overhaul in the summer. And there's probably some there looking for contracts, some not too sure they're going to be here, if they're in their plans. And everyone's just in a little bit of limbo. But I think the obvious thing is JJ is going nowhere.
I believe that is the case. Neither is our new head of football operations, as you'd expect, really, because he's only a few months into the job. But Craig Cope, extensive interview with him on the official website this week. And you were impressed with what he had to say?
Yeah, do you know what? I've met him quite a few times. I was involved in interviewing him initially, so I was with 4PLs helping out doing a recording and that. So I spoke to him there, and that was very much an official sort of. Hey, look, it was very very rehearsed in terms of, you know, in terms of what, you know, he's coming in to do, and I've been fortunate enough to chat to him at games. Nice guy, really like him, knows his football. So I suppose from a personal point of view, I did have a bit of an insight in terms of what, you know, I'm nosy, so I ask questions and stuff like that. But it was probably important for him to do something more for fans who have not had that chance. And I think what he covered was really good. I've been saying to you for a little while, his job isn't just recruitment. There's a lot to what he does. And, you know, it's interesting. He was talking about style of play, making sure we recruit the right players for how we're going to play, looking at training, looking at, you know, the training ground, and, you know, I think they're putting a new kitchen in, and they're right. You know, you're not far away from King's College ground, are you, in terms of, you know, it's shared. You know, if you go there on a Wednesday, we don't have the canteen availability on the Wednesday. You know, that's the thing about it. You know, it's a shared facility. Yes, we have majority of it, but yes, it could, because I think it's like anything. You know, if you're attracting players, what are you attracting? So you're attracting them to Plough Lane, which is a lovely place, but most of their work is done in a week at training ground. So it's all that, you know, it's all about buying into it, you know, and that sort of side. It's not saying that training ground's poor, but it could do a bit of TLC. No doubt about that. So he's getting involved in that. He's done an audit on training the last couple of seasons as to what injuries, like soft tissue injuries and stuff, which it hasn't taken just this last 2 months for you and I to work out we get injuries too much. I think we've all known that, haven't we? So hey, look, it's just being smarter with the money we're spending. And there's a lot that he's doing. So it's really encouraging. An encouraging update, but of course the proof's in the pudding as anything.
The proof of the pudding is indeed in the eating. The training ground, Johnny Jackson said it, meet the manager back in the summer. If you could change one thing, what would it be? Training ground, straight away. No hesitation.
Yeah, that was his answer.
So tells you all you need to know. Andy Thorn,
yes,
returns to the club as our chief scout, which has given a few people a little bit of springs in their steps, I think.
Well, yeah, I think if you're old school, Andy Thorn, you know, I don't remember his first time. I remember his second time at Wimbledon back in the 90s. But if you, you know, if you're just going to go on the fact he's an old name, then that's a bit of a red herring, because actually, if you look at his experience, been at West Brom, been at, I think, Celtic, part of England, part of Palace. So as a head scout, he's got a lot of experience. But of course, he's got an affiliation with the club, and I think he's a local person as well. So, and Craig Coate was interesting when he said, you know, he didn't say he bought Andy Thorn because of his connection. He said he bought him because he's totally different to what he is, and he wanted to have someone different, which is great. You don't want yes people. You know, you want a team of people, don't you? So yeah, that's really encouraging. I'm not too sure scout wise if we've had a head scout before. It's not something, you know, look, if we look going back to the days of Simon Bassey, he was basically a scout, wasn't he? And seeing loads of games. So it's always been difficult to know what scouting network we have. But I don't know about you, it just felt like there was a plan. It's the first summer coming into the summer that I felt we've had a plan. Normally we've sacked a manager by now. I know some fans are going to be like, well, we should still be sacking a manager. But I think when you read, if you haven't read the article yet, there's a very strong sense there of stability, setting something up. So I think JJ could lose every game now at the end of the season and he's staying, because they have a plan, they want to implement it, and JJ's part of that. And you know what? I get that. You know, you need that. What's the worst thing Craig could be doing now is working with a new manager when he's been setting a plan up for the last 6-8 weeks.
I mean, all I would say is that if ever a head of football operations at AFC Wimbledon was going to have a surname, Cope, I think, is probably the most apt it could ever be.
Do you know what? I think one thing he says in the interview is he basically said, I'm all in, which is not, he's not playing poker.
Stop with the wrestling references. There are going to be people listening to this would have heard all in, and they'd have heard a big wrestling reference that a lot of people won't get. But anyway, you were saying.
But it's a really important thing. He's fully submersed himself in this. You know, it feels to me like he's playing catch up. He wants to know about the club, you know, wants to know what makes it ticks. And he loves it. You know, like I say, I've been lucky enough to chat to him personally. And he loves it. You can just tell. It just doesn't feel to me like it's an act. He generally likes the story. You know, some people said to me, like, what style do you think we're going to play? I've referenced, I think we're going to follow very, and I don't know this. I'm just surmising. That he wants to, you know, he said he wants to have a team represent Wimbledon. Well, I think Luton's style of play and their recruitment probably is similar to what we would want. I know you, but that's, I don't know about you, but I think Luton's up and at them, high tempo, strong, aggressive, is a style that Wimbledon fans would really want as theirs and relates to them.
Yeah, I mean, we won't go to too, but, you know, obviously, Luton Club very close to my heart, but there are so many similarities between the two clubs, not least winning at Wembley in 1988 amongst them. But yeah, just there are so many parallels, and what the advantage Luton have had over us is the fact that they remained at their stadium, the stadium that everyone hates, that everyone doesn't like going to, but it's such a huge asset for them in the way that Plough Lane was an asset to us on the original Wimbledon FC days. And sadly, so far, 2 years into crowds at Plough Lane, and Plough Lane hasn't quite, in terms of results, been that for us yet, but I'm sure we will get there. Plough Lane has been very popular with many things that it can offer, including a fan zone with lots of food outlets that are proving very popular, and a pub and live music and all sorts of things. What's proving unpopular is the fucking PA system. Just
live,
just too fucking loud. But anyway,
live music. Now, I'm going to sound old now. I know I am getting up. I'm getting that
you
way.
Getting, like, yeah, yeah.
I mean, but what is it with this live DJ and the Phoenix, right?
I had no idea what was going on. I was so confused. But you know what? Second half kicked off and that's all you could hear. From the West Stand.
It's so difficult, like, because I get it, you know, but I don't think the Phoenix needs a DJ at half time.
No.
I think it does after the game once you're done. But I literally was talking, like, one of the people that I know, Grace, who was you know, a Glebe, and she would come down to football. She was right next to me, and I could not hear a word she was saying.
No.
Like, her mouth was moving, but I had no idea what was coming out of it.
No.
And all I could hear was this, oh, I'm going to sound really old, this boom, boom, boom thing. And I'm like,
Finger Boys.
Apparently, one of my songs was on the playlist.
Jesus.
I put on there Wigfield Saturday night. And I missed it because we were doing the show. That was silly.
Gutted.
But yeah. Do you know what? In all seriousness, it's just too loud everywhere. And it's really weird, isn't it? We've gone from King's Meadow where we couldn't hear anything. And if we did put the music up too loud, we felt like the tunnel was going to break.
Yeah.
And now it feels like we're trying to get, like, it feels like we're trying to attract fans from Fulham and Chelsea on the day, because it could probably reach that far, the music. It is, it's just too loud. And I've got hearing aids now, which are really good. I'm not wearing my hearing aids because it just makes it louder.
Yeah, I was going to say that would knock you out. It'd be too much for you to cope with. But anyway, yes, so Plough Lane anyway. Aside from that, certainly the catering and other parts of elements of Plough Lane, the matchday experience being very positively spoken about. I was listening to the Same Old Wombles podcast this week, and Adam Proctor was talking about somebody he bumped into en route to the game and then bumped into him again before the game at the stadium. Somebody who travelled up from Southampton on the day was ticking off Plough Lane as a neutral, I believe, and was very positive about the experience. But this was all pre-match. Adam would then go on to say that, you know, he's not sure what his thoughts would have been post-match, and ensued a conversation about attracting fans with the facilities we have, such as the pub inside the stadium and the fan zone and my pie and pizza dough shack, whatever it is. The whole conversation just made me just think and just reinforce my points to you, as I think we are seeing and we are bearing witness to at the moment with the amount of empty seats at Plough Lane. Hey, look, it's great having all these things, having the pub, having a fan zone, having a man of the match that people go to. Da, 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 da. At the end of the day, what is bringing people to Plough Lane? It's what happens on the pitch between 3 o'clock and 4:45. And we just need to remember that, because I just think at times at Wimbledon we overthink things. Biggest generator of supporters and returning supporters, people coming back time after time, will be what happens from the moment they sit in their seat to watch the game until that game ends.
Yeah, I agree. You know, the match day experience before the game was great. Yeah, you can't argue with that. I think we've all said that. But what we don't want to do is turn out to be some sort of team that's for tourists, such, or
Hamlet, for example.
Yeah, you know, they come to one game now and then, and it's a really lovely experience. But what's bringing them back is the Mai Tai or Naked Chips or the Phoenix or just generally the whole atmosphere, you know, families and stuff like that. But actually, the football is not an importance to them. an actual problem. You know, Danny Macklin, when he was looking at his kids for, I think, a match for Fiverr and stuff like that, was talking about getting data on these people. So, you know, touching base with them, saying, how did you enjoy your game? Make sure they come back. Because that's what you want. You don't want to be a tourist situation where they just come in now and then. How do you build a fan base up? It's difficult because, you know, we've done well with average attendances getting relegated into League Two. But we are, I think all of us are a little bit sceptical on how we're going to do season ticket sales next season.
Yeah.
You know, it may not, it might just be, you know, I thought our attendances would go down by about 1,000 on average. And I haven't really gone down that much. But will a second season in League Two do that? So I think you're right. You know, like, do we know that person stayed beyond half time?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
You know, but yes, the experience is great, but it's a football club. And I think that's, you're right. You know, it's about a product on the pitch. I know some people that get to the game at 10-3 and they leave at full time. That's all they see. That's what they want to do. They just want to come watch football. And that's how they're going to come back. So whilst we need our tourists, and I mean that in the politest possible way, we do need our diehards who are going to come through thick and thin. And we just need to, yeah, you're right, we need to remember that.
Okay, so we're now joined by Kerry and Esther from the Women of Wimbledon Supporters Association. Henceforth, we shall refer to it as WOWSA. Kerry, you were with us on 9 years TV when you had the big launch day, I think, for the game against Crawley a couple of weeks ago. Just for people that aren't familiar, can you just give a quick rundown of what WOWSA is and what you've been up to since that launch day?
Yeah, so we are a independent supporters association is a membership scheme, so people can sign up and join, and there's some certain benefits to being a member. And what we're really aiming to do is encourage more women to come to football, try and enhance the experience of women on a match day. We're looking to support the club with their diversity and inclusion agenda. And support the foundation with the women and girls events. Really, it's just about getting more women to matches and enhancing their experiences and supporting the club with some of the really good stuff that they already do.
And I think Kerry's point there is absolutely correct. It's supporting the great work that the club already do. It's not about thinking that work isn't already being done, and it is very well, but it is just seeing what we can do to elevate it and help support it. You know, we want to encourage more families. We see so many families at the ground already, which is fantastic. We want to just keep encouraging them to come, and, you know, knowing that there's a place with WOWSA where they can talk to us, or we can help assist them, especially if people are sort of nervous about coming to games where it might be their first time.
So I noticed that on Saturday for the home defeat against Rochdale, we won't talk about defeat too much, but the foundation you were involved in. The WOWSA have got involved with that, I understand. Is that right?
Yeah, they reached out to us to see if we could put a shout out for volunteers. So some of the women on our socials stepped forward and said, yeah, we're willing to help out. And they did a great job selling raffle tickets and handing out leaflets and just kind of spreading the word about what the foundation does.
Cool.
So you've had a few women via WOWSA have started to attend games very recently, Crawley and Rochdale, as Stu's mentioned. What have they said about their experiences? Like, the two-part question, really. One is, what were their barriers to them coming to football previously? And what did they sort of say or think about their experience at AFC Wimbledon?
Correct me if I'm wrong. I think it's people that have recently got in touch who want to come or are coming to future games. And I think, you know, it's very much about somebody who might be coming on her own. In fact, we've had somebody from overseas who's booked a ticket to the last game of the season. But they're coming on their own, and they were pointed to us and got in touch, and, you know, we've gone back to them and given them, you know, information about, you know, how to get to the ground, what goes on at the ground, that it's a great environment, and that, you know, if they want to come and meet us and have someone to kind of join when they arrive, then that's there. So that's what it's about. And I think, you know, that's exactly the fundamental point of WOWSA.
So some of the attendees at Women at the Game, which was the event that the foundation hosted, we did a piece about what to expect on a match day, some of the security elements of how to feel safe at a match. So head of security did a talk about what they look out for on a match day, how the security works, and what to do if you feel unsafe at a match. So I think that's some of the misconception about coming to football, that women feel unsafe, and there's a male-dominated environment, which we know that it is, but it doesn't mean that it's not a safe environment. So it's about helping women understand what that environment looks like on the other side of the gates, break down some of the barriers about what to expect, help them understand where's a good place to book a ticket, what to expect from the different stands. If you want, looking for more of a atmospheric, what to book in the south stand. If you're looking for more of an family environment, where the family stand is. And also, yeah, like Esther said, being a point of contact so that we can meet up with fans before a match, and show them around.
And is that home games and away games? Is that something that's come up yet, or is it sort of starting point being Plough Lane and going from there?
So away games is definitely on the agenda. Me and Esther love an away game, don't we?
Absolutely. Win, lose or draw, we still go and do it. And it's a great day out, isn't it? It's not just about the football.
Yeah, absolutely. So yeah, we definitely want to host some away matches. I'm sure there are women out there that have never been to an away match. Mm. So we'd love to be able to host that.
I'm sure if Esther, go.
No, I was going to say just on that, actually, quite recently at Leighton Orient Away, a few of us went on the non-official boat down the Thames. And, you know, there were a group of us, women all together, and this lady just came up to us and just said, "Oh, I'm so pleased to see other women on here. I feel a lot safer and a lot better about coming on here." And we just said, "Well, if you want to come and chat to us, we're about." You know, she didn't, but I think just knowing that there was another group of women there and that she just touched base with them, she felt a lot more comfortable about it. And then we saw her later on and she was having a great day.
So you did, let me correct, you were on the officially unofficial boat to Lake Nora, is that right?
However you want to phrase it, Stu, however you want to phrase it. Unofficial boats.
The official unofficial boat. I was just going to say, I can imagine your prep for an away game would be like, this is the wine list, this is the alcohol list, this is the time you start. Have you adapted that yet?
It's always about making sure you've got enough booze for the journey and having something to line your stomach with. Is it going to be Burger King or is it going to be Pret? Big decisions of the day.
But you know what? It's interesting, isn't it? Because you're right. You know, they probably enjoy the experience, may enjoy Plough Lane, and normally the next step is to go to an away game or, you know, to advance it and stuff like that, isn't it? So I think that's really good in terms of you doing that. But I was just being cheeky. Obviously, I've been don't go to away games much now, but I do remember both of you from years ago.
Well, you know, we're a bit more mature now. And, you know, Stu, you're welcome to come and join us to a away game, especially if you're feeling uncomfortable, a bit nervous about it. That's what we're here for.
You'd drink me under the table, you lot would, before I go out of London, probably.
You don't forget, we're looking to organise 104% unofficial travel in the future. But going back to the WOWSA membership for a minute. So I understand at the moment membership is growing. I think you said 50-ish paid members now.
We've got over 50 members. We're not looking to measure ourselves by the number of members, but we get a lot of engagement with our socials as well. It's quite nice. On Facebook, we've got a group set up, and that's a really nice place for women to chat football and about their experiences at matches. So it's not really about just the numbers, but we are growing in numbers. We're having new members each week. It's going well.
And I think just to point out, it's not just women that are joining. It's you know, and the whole remit is that it's not just a women's group. It's for anyone to join who's 14 years or older, over, and who kind of agrees with what we're aiming to do. So we do have some men who've joined up, which is great to see. And, you know, and that's it. It's an all-inclusive group that, you know, as Kerry pointed out, is aiming to achieve certain things and you know, increase the experience of women. And I think that's been really encouraging for us to see that too.
What's the support been like from within the club?
The support has been fantastic. We were very open and transparent right from the beginning of the sort of idea. So the club, Danny Macklin and a couple of the other staff were involved in those conversations and, you know, really supported with what, you know, supported what we were aiming to do. And, you know, wider, we've had support from the PLC board. You know, we've, you know, got support from other groups like the foundation, the women's team and, you know, Dons for Diversity. And, you know, at the end of the day, it's all one kind of big aim, which is just to make everything, you know, everyone's experience at AFC Wimbledon the best it can possibly be.
And for anyone that is listening that's interested in becoming a member, taking part, joining on the social media, where's the best, where should we direct them to? Where's the best place for them to go?
Well, you need to go to WOWSA.uk, and that is our website. And additionally, we're on Twitter, which is at Womble Women. And our Facebook group is the Women of Wimbledon Supporters Association.
Perfect. Well, Esther, Kerry, thank you very much. All the best moving forward with the WOWSA group. Sure, we'll hear more about you coming over the coming weeks and certainly into next season as well.
Thank you. Thank you.
Conscious of time, Stu, we will very quickly look ahead to Harrogate and Salford over the Easter weekend. But just as a quick Jackson 5, I think this is quite tricky. I've picked out 5 memorable Easter Monday games that we've had since 2002. So since the inception of AFC Wimbledon, okay? It's almost impossible. It's very difficult. Originally, I was going to do Good Friday games, but when I put the list together, I thought no one's going to have any chance of this. So what I'm going to do, Stu, is I'm going to give you the year in which a famous Easter Monday fixture was played. And I'd just like to tell you if you can remember who we played that year on Easter Monday, and if perhaps what the score might have been as well. So let's start. Do you remember who we played in our first Easter Monday fixture as AFC Wimbledon way back in 2003?
I'm going to say, let's think who's in that. Oh, crikey. I don't think Facebook Vale weren't in our league then, were they? Or were they? That sounds like an Easter Monday game. Sounds like it's a game. I'm only saying that because like, we moved it so many times, didn't we? It felt like the fixture. 5-0.
That's the one. Well done, yeah. We played, do you remember where it was played?
Gander Green Lane.
No.
Was it not? No. We did play there against them, didn't we?
We did the following season and we won 3-2 at Gander Green Lane on a mud path. No, it was at Carl Shorten.
So we never played them at Rains Park Vale, did we?
No, they could never have hosted it at Rains Park Vale. Grand Avenue would never have been able to.
Shame, isn't it? But yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Cool. There you go. So yeah, 1-1. What about the following season, 2004?
We'd been the same division, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
I'm going to go for one of the teams we struggled with. With Dean?
It wasn't with Dean. Do you know what? It was a team that also began with W, though. It was...
Watford.
No. Walton Casuals. We won 3-0. And that was the game that confirmed us as champions of the CCL.
So, yeah. It's weird how you remember certain games, isn't it? Do you know what I mean? But yeah, I remember Walton Casuals, lovely club, lovely part of Surrey.
Yes. I think there are a few times in various competitions and things like that. Right, how about 2009?
That would have been what? Conference South?
Conference South, yeah.
Hampton and Richmond.
It wasn't Hampton and Richmond, sadly, because I think we played them a couple of weeks later when we got the 1-1 draw that got us promoted. The reason I chose this one is a very famous game for a very famous incident. And it would have been at our favourite rivals in non-league, Bromley.
Oh, Bromley. Oh, what, the one all game where Mr...
Well, 2-2, yeah, but...
Yeah. Bromley, they did... They chucking us at these places, didn't they?
Yeah. But the famous game, you know, where, yeah, they should have kicked the ball back to James Pullen, but they kicked it into the net.
Ryan Hall, wasn't it?
Ryan Hall, who'd later go and play against us in the Football League for Southend. And, Rocky Baptiste scored, I think, his own goal for us that day as well.
But anyway. Yeah. Crikey, that's a name from the past, isn't it?
Two more. How about 2022? say it in other ways, last season.
Do you know what? This is really sad because I did actually look at them for looking at what we've done last time. We didn't win, I know that. Oh, crikey.
No.
I can't remember who it was now. I was looking at Fleetwood.
No. Do you know who it was? Adebayo Akinfenwa scored the equaliser.
Wickham.
Yeah. The one-all draw with Wickham. Yep.
I think we might play for Fleetwood before. I know they were definitely in that. Okay.
Yeah, there's a few W's here, isn't there? There's Wickham, Walton Casuals, Bromley. W word we could use for them, but I won't. and finally, how about this one? A slightly trick question, this one. 2018.
I would say we didn't because that was a COVID season.
No, that was not the COVID season. 2018, Stu, your timelines have gone all over the shop.
Damn. Who did we play then?
Do you know what, though? You are quite right. We didn't have a game, but do you remember why?
Because we didn't celebrate Easter. We didn't have an Easter. We had no Easter eggs left.
Yeah.
Why did we not play?
We did not play.
Waterlogged it?
Yes. Where? Do you not remember this? Okay, obviously not.
Obviously not.
No, we were on our way up to Doncaster on the train.
Oh, we spoke about this all week, didn't we?
We did speak about this the other week. And a Warthogs on the pitch got it postponed, which we thought was coming, but we were also kind of like, if you do remember a team you just mentioned a moment ago, Fleetwood Town, we played on the Good Friday when the game should have been abandoned because the ball was not moving properly across the pitch, but the game went ahead and we lost 1-0.
Yeah, the ball will travel across the pitch. Look, throws it, doesn't move.
Doesn't go anywhere.
Although, say that, Matt, have you seen that with the, what was it? Is it Cardiff Black? No,
oh,
Cardiff
Rotherham. Rotherham, yeah.
And they've got their attempts to get the ball off the pitch.
Yeah,
and
brilliant.
The FA has said you've got to play the whole game again.
Yeah.
Oh, mate, yeah.
I mean,
anyway, I digress, but they didn't really try that hard, did they?
It's no, but again, it was Cardiff, so my sympathy is in short supply, I'm afraid. Right, so I'm not going to do great detailed previews of the next two games, because we said earlier, Stu, season's over, no one cares. We unfortunately have two teams this weekend. I can't see us losing both games, because I just don't think we will lose both games, but they are against teams that have got things to play for. Salford, we play on Monday. We host them at Plough Lane. Believe they've sold about 12 tickets for it. But they are currently seventh. They host Leighton Orient before they come to us. So who knows where they'll be come Monday. But they're in good form at the moment, Salford, and doing quite well. So tough game. Before that, we travel to Harrogate. Got your ticket?
No, do you know what? I went. I tried to get them and it said no room at the inn.
We're not going to go down that rabbit hole of the ticketing situation, but, you know, steps have been put in place to ensure that the issue doesn't arise again.
It's not, isn't it? You know, look, I think Danny Macklin has resolved it and they've done a very good idea with the thing, but I don't think, you're right, 600 people did find tickets. The thing is, the surprising thing is, not quite a few people that I know go to a lot of away games have not got tickets. So I think what I'm grasping is there is I don't do away games anymore. So I'm grasping there's a culture where just paying a gate is still there. So maybe something that's just historically with away games, it's caught a few out. But yeah, you're right. 600 people did get tickets. And that's a good attendance up there.
Yeah, it's very, very good attendance. Would be more, there are problems Harrogate are doing something to their staging, which is why it's slightly reduced as well. But bottom line is we have demand, which supply can't match on this occasion, unfortunately. So anyway, one of those things. And hopefully those fans that do travel away regularly and perhaps those that have been to every game this season that didn't manage to get a ticket, hopefully something will be sorted out for them so they don't lose their run at this late stage of the season, what should otherwise be a nice little trip because it's a nice part of the country. Anyway, what interests me about this one, Stu, is that Hartlepool, Harrogate are 20th. They are 4 points from safety. And realistically, I think we're looking at one from four to join Rochdale in non-league next season. And that is Hartlepool, Crawley, Colchester, and then obviously Harrogate. Harrogate host us on Friday. They will consider this must win. They travel to Leighton Orient on Easter Monday. So good luck with that. So they will be looking at us and thinking this is going to be their cup final, really. This for them will be 3 points. I look around the other teams just over Easter weekend, just to be interesting, some tough games. Colchester still right in the mix. They travel to Stevenage first, but then they host Crewe on Easter Monday. So again, Crewe at home for them will be there nailed on. They've got to win that one, 3 points. Crawley host Bradford and then travel to Barrow. That's who on earth gave Crawley Barrow on Easter Monday? Who does? Well, again, we've got Salford, I suppose, but it's not like the days of Wharton Casuals and Rains Park Vale, is it? No. And Hartlepool, they travel to Grimsby, fair enough, on Good Friday. Easter Monday, they host Stevenage. Stevenage and Orient seem to be right in the mix of important fixtures this weekend, but it's tough. I mean, I really hope that, I'm not going to lie, I'm not going to dress this up. I really hope Crawley go down, but it's going to be tough.
Yeah, do you know what? I wouldn't lose any sleep with Crawley getting relegated, be truthful, but when I looked when they played us, I think they've got a good team. If I looked at it, I think they'd be the ones that probably would stay up. I don't see us getting much on Friday against Harrogate. I really don't. I think it's one of those places that I just think it's, I don't know, I just don't have a good feeling about it at all. I wouldn't be surprised if we come away from this Easter weekend with no win. I really wouldn't be surprised at all.
No, I mean, season's over anyway, but you know what? I don't see us losing both games. I just don't think teams really do lose both games over this weekend. But, you know, I think we can perhaps upset Salford with a point at home, but I'm not expecting anything from Harrogate, though.
No, and you look at Salford, they've had a hell of a run in them. They played a lot of teams around them, Stockport, Carlisle, Stevenage, Leighton Orient. So they've had a really hefty, scored a lot of goals. It means something to them. It's a difficult one, isn't it? You know, I'd love to say we can upset, because it would be an upset if we beat Salford, let's be straight. And that sounds mad when you think about it. But I can probably see 2 points, two draws. I can't see us winning either.
Well, updates will be on Twitter at 9Wires Podcast for both games anyway. And 9Years TV will bring you the build-up and reaction on YouTube and Facebook to the game on Monday when Salford come down to Plough Lane. But, Stu, all that said, we're running out of time. Won't get a chance to really give my thoughts on WrestleMania, perhaps again an example at the end of WrestleMania or the two nights of a company overthinking things and therefore making life more difficult for themselves. Where have we heard that before? But we're not going to go down that rabbit hole, as I said earlier this week, because that is it. So, Stu, thank you very much for joining me.
Thank you.
Thank you to everybody for listening. Thank you to Esther and Kerry for joining us as well. But that is it for this week. Thankfully, not long to go. But Alexa Bliss, bag first, milk last. 2 plus 2 equals 4. And we shall speak to you again next week.